Good morning, this is the July 14th meeting of the ReUse Committee. We're no longer a subcommittee, is that right? Yes, we are a committee.
We're the ReUse Committee.
Yeah, great.
Well, we'll get into that.
All right. Have people read the June 9th minutes? I see Debbie nodding her head.
Does anyone need copies?
I did.
Roger did. Were there any edits? John?
He's here.
Oh, here are copies. Copies.
Did you resolve that issue with the...
Yes. John, you were correct. You got it right.
Nice.
In the minutes, John had pointed out that the two dumpsters were talking in reference to the recycling rally that was in April.
That was spring.
Yeah. There was a large 40-yard dumpster and two smaller dumpsters, and it was preferred that we use the large dumpster for the styrofoam because of the distance it had to go, and if you use the small dumpsters, two trips have to be made. So John pointed out that the two dumpsters were larger, that the combination of the two dumpsters was larger than the one dumpster. And he was correct. These two small dumpsters were 30 yards each, making a total of 60 yards. And the other dumpster was 40 yards. However, Scott, who is very happy to meet with us, we plan this for next fall, said that the first dumpster, one of the dumpsters wasn't very well packed, and that the other dumpster wasn't full. So he feels that it could have fit in the 40-yard dumpster. But I mean, he didn't have a major problem with it. It's just something to be aware of. He said that it wasn't just the two trips. There are other issues at play as to which dumpsters make the most sense to use. Because he's got to constantly juggle certain dumpsters because he can only use a certain dumpster at Glendale because if he uses one that's too tall, people can't throw stuff over it. So he's got a certain repertoire that he has to work with, and he kind of juggles them. And so. Yeah.
Better communication.
But you were correct.
I have a clarification for the minutes.
Mm-hmm.
It says Susan is talking with Donna about her position and the role she is to fill. Now, if I were coming in from the cold, I wouldn't know who Donna was. Last name is, is this the new head of the DPW?
Yes.
Okay, so that should be
Good point,
defined.
David.
Really? Is her name not in there?
Ah, oh, John.
Donna, so her last name is?
I have no idea.
That's why I didn't write it.
If you want to be consistent on your action plan, you have the same thing. When you're talking about follow-up to work Anna did last summer, who's Anna?
Right. Good point.
Mentioned it earlier.
Give me another one.
Oh, yeah, you know what? Her name
does
is here.
Does mention it earlier.
Oh, does it?
Oh, it is, yeah. It is up there, okay. You guys. Yeah, it's in a paragraph above, and then it would be good to have her name again.
Okay.
Just to, and then Anna, you're right. Anna, it just doesn't say. It doesn't say. And that might have been one that I added. I might have added that in, so
okay.
That would might have been my bad.
Anna Moore.
Okay.
And Maria too. Do we want her last name or is that?
Oh, yeah.
Informal kind of group here.
Yeah.
That's Maria's last name.
Spert Judy.
Spertuti,
S-P-E-R-D-U-T-I,
I think.
Yes, that is correct.
Say it again.
S-P-E-R-D-U-T-I.
D-U?
D-U, T-I.
Got it.
Cool. Okay, any other edits or corrections?
Yeah, a small one. The Grace House is in Northampton. It's not in Holyoke.
Where's that one?
It's on the second page, on the third.
Also on a positive.
Yeah, Mercado.
Oh, yes, in Northampton. Okay. 20 lashes with a wet noodle. John,
it's
really not a big deal.
So.
Thank you for taking that.
Anybody else? Anything else? Motion to approve the minutes as edited?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All right. Any blocking concerns? No? Okay. Strawberry Social. John, were you there?
I was. David was there. Marie was there and Jessica was there. It was lovely. Some people have already done it, and it's
not Jessica Gifford, but Jessica
Tanner.
Right.
Jessica it was useful to be there. They had a nice setup with lots of food and great music. The O-Tones played, but the stations that we were at, even with the River Valley Co-op crowd, it was helpful to have people standing there telling people where to put stuff. Food, I think people get is compost, but plates, napkins, and the utensils especially, people really had a hard time taking a fork and dropping the compost. Even though it says compostable, and there's a sign, and there's a picture, people had a hard time with that. So it's an educational process.
It was very educational.
It was.
For them.
Yes, absolutely. So it was a good thing that we're there. We ended up with bags and bags of compost, which they take. I don't know what they do with it, but they have a composting machine there, and maybe a bag of garbage. I think the whole day, 4 hours, hundreds of people, a bag of garbage. So
nice.
The Taste of Amherst is a fairly zero waste event, and we have. I was not as involved this year as I have been in years past, but we have waste sort tents with similar things with people there helping out, and it's work, but it is such an amazing experience because you are opening the minds and enlightening people, hundreds and hundreds of people, and people ask questions or people it's a really exciting experience, and so this is a really good thing to do because we're promoting the concept and helping people think about, oh, well, maybe that fork shouldn't go into a landfill. You know what I mean? Maybe I should buy biodegradable forks. So it's a good thing, and they are very appreciative every year, and thank you guys for doing that.
Gum is an edible item. People have trouble putting into the compost.
Yeah.
Well, it actually has plastic in it now. It used to be made, yeah.
Gum has plastic?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you should research that. I wouldn't put it in.
Gum does not go in compost?
I would not put gum in compost myself because it now is made with plastic. I've been told, and it was a fairly good source. I have not confirmed that.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Would you recommend swallowing it now?
I would recommend putting it in the trash.
How about on the bedpost overnight?
It used to be made with.
What if it's glee gum?
It might come up.
That's what we have in our bedding.
It used to be made with a nap from a plant.
I'm sure
the
plastic
today.
Right.
Okay. Thanks, John.
Is that it, David?
Worth doing next year, though, it sounds like, John and David.
What's that?
Sounds like it's worth doing
it
again next year.
And they're very appreciative. They give you a free meal, and you get to hear music and talk to people. It's a neighborhood thing. It's a community event, so it's a nice thing to be present for. We didn't have any recenter signs, I don't believe, or any pamphlet to think about.
That's a missed opportunity.
Yeah, can you make note of that? That would be a good thing to
have. Okay. Potential.
Or if I may add one more thing.
Yeah, go ahead.
It would also be really cool to have some kind of T-shirts or something, that would
for our volunteers.
Our volunteers.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's a great idea.
You know, I'm here from the reuse committee, or something like that. So make note that would be cool.
Yeah. Well, we have recenter T-shirts people can wear too.
Uh-huh.
Again.
Yes.
On a less good note, they're finding plastic in sea salt.
Oh, God.
And all the plastic that's degrading in the ocean.
So we shouldn't be that surprised that there's plastic in gum, then.
Yeah.
Right? It's probably everywhere. It's probably ubiquitous.
Yeah.
Is it like 30% of our bodies now?
Is that right?
I saw that on Facebook.
Yeah. Well, 3D printing will be soon.
Oh, my God.
Okay, potential administrative change.
Yes. So Ro and I had mentioned that the mayor had been, because the Public Works Commission is going away, it leaves this group without a kind of official home. And so the mayor had is interested in giving us a home and he's very supportive of this group and wants to give us a home. So. He's toying with the idea of making us a commission, or not a commission, making us a group similar to the Shade Tree Shade Tree Commission?
Yeah.
So the way it works is because we were not, there were only Roe pretty much, well, Roe and David were representing from the Public Works Commission. This was more, when you look in the realm of what committees are normal and official and acceptable in a municipal environment, this committee was a sort of more of an ad hoc committee because it wasn't a true subcommittee because it wasn't made of members of the Public Works Commission. It was made of two members plus some others. So it was more of an advisory kind of ad hoc kind of thing. And we've flown under the radar for a while. And so he's just trying to make this a more, make this, give this a home and make it legitimate. So I spoke with him yesterday briefly. He would like to, I'm trying to think if I have my notes from that discussion. He would like to, he's interested in finding out what our our wishes would be as far as what would happen if it were to become a entity like the Shade Tree Committee. We would have to, it wouldn't change things a whole lot. We still would have to post meetings. We would be subject to the open meeting law. The recenter probably would not be a, it doesn't make a lot of sense to have the recenter committee being a separate committee from the reuse committee, but maybe the reuse committee shouldn't be called the reuse committee. Maybe it should be called the waste reduction committee, and then have the have the recenter a subcommittee of that. So he's open to ideas. There's not a huge rush on this. What I would recommend is that we come up with a we have a special meeting to brainstorm, and I will bring the information about what the different committees, what the different options are. There aren't a whole lot of options. Essentially, this is an advisory. You guys are, as citizens, are an advisory type group, and you would be advisory to the DPW, and that's essentially what you've been doing. You've been advisory to me in my position, an advisory to the DPW. And so how that works and what we can certainly make a proposal, and I'm going to be delving into it a little deeper. I appreciate the work that Diana did looking into it for her email. Did everyone see Diana's email?
I wasn't clear if that was an email for the reuse committee or for the recenter committee. I never got an answer to that, so I think I only sent it to the recenter committee because we talked about it as that group without being here. So no, I didn't send it out to the wider group.
When does the Public Works Commission officially leave?
I don't know. David, do you have a sense of that?
I don't. It's just the technicality of when it was, when and if it was presented to the city council.
So you still have scheduled meetings? Do you still have scheduled meetings?
There's nothing presently scheduled.
Oh, okay.
In this interim period of confusion, we had a couple, there were a couple of public hearings that the city had to do that would have involved the DPW. And at that point, we hadn't been canceled yet officially by the city council, so we did conduct those two hearings a couple of weeks ago.
Well, so
only because we haven't been, we're bleeding, but we're not dead.
So, looking over my notes.
Chicken with its head cut off.
That sounds uncomfortable.
Yeah. Almost dead.
Looking over my notes from my discussion with the mayor, he wants to codify us in some way so that it's an official organization. And so we can influence that. And we talked about, it doesn't make sense to look, is reuse too limiting, and does it make sense to expand that, since we also do things like support composting and
recycling? Just reuse. So, I don't think that's, yeah. I don't well, think I mean, terminology is that, I don't think that should hold us back from
well,
moving
when,
it forward.
I do.
But when you're, oh, thank you so much, Sweeney. When you're officially codifying it, it might make sense to do that. So I would recommend that we have a, it doesn't have to be super long, but have a separate meeting to come up with things that we, so that you guys have a say or have a voice.
Could that be today after this meeting? I just don't want to hold it up. It doesn't seem any reason to hold it up.
Well,
I don't see any reason to not be...
well, you know what we could do?
The
what?
Mayor can only move so fast because it's summertime.
Right, I know, but we shouldn't hold it up. Like,
you know what? Our agenda's not that long. If we get through it, we can come back to this item and discuss it at this meeting.
Great.
Okay, and if we do not, then what?
Then we'll come back to it and say, okay, when are we going to talk about this?
Okay.
Recenter report. Operations update.
Mac, did you feel that one? Bless you.
Thank you.
I'll start. Yeah, things are going, I think, quite smoothly, except for, as noted in the minutes, the issue with people signing up in advance to work out there. We've been able to cover it every weekend, but it's been up to the final day or two before we've been sure that we can open, and that includes this weekend. There's nobody signed up to supervise.
Wait,
right now.
I am. How is this not happening?
Wait, no, I didn't see your name on there, Diana.
You're not on there.
I got an email
something
that said
happening.
That you were going to do it, but I didn't see you signed up.
Oh,
for
yeah,
it.
Yeah, because I looked this morning and nobody was.
Yeah, I have it on my schedule. I've done this twice now.
Okay, pass that back to Diana, please.
Diana.
Got a torch. I'm supervising, but I...
How many other people
oh, good,
are
okay.
There? I
so,
mean, I'm going to be there.
And Alan has been working up a list of summer
oh.
weekends with the idea of making sure that all the Saturdays are covered with supervisors, and he'll give us a report on that, I think.
Yes, we have everything up through Labor Day as far as a supervisor, including Dinah's name didn't get on the list, but she was on for this weekend. And so you're on for next weekend, and then I'm on the weekend after. David, you're doing the 6th of August, I'm doing the 13th. Dinah's back on the 20th, and Mac is back on the 27th. So that brings us up to the Labor Day weekend. I'm away that weekend myself.
I should be around Labor Day weekend, so I can probably do that.
Yeah, so that's been a challenge, but evidently we're doing okay. we have attempted to do some publicity to get some other volunteers involved.
What kind of publicity? Or do you want to just
go through? Well, we put stuff on list. Did that stuff get posted
on the listservs?
On the neighborhood listservs, and we've also talked about the business card and the coupon, and you know, part of this is not just getting people to sign up, but it's getting people out there, getting them interested, seeing who shows up a lot. And as I've said before, I'm getting very aggressive about if someone shows up a lot and they seem to have good people skills, I'm patting them on the back and saying, you're coming out here anyway, give us one Saturday morning a month. And you know, there's a few people that are responding to that, so that's an ongoing challenge.
I would like to spend some energy talking about the volunteer situation, not just talking about it, but planning it. It really is one of the most critical things. We can spend a lot of time talking about all these other projects that we want to work on, but when push comes to shove, if we don't have a core of volunteers that are making this work, we might as well throw in the towel. So I really think that this deserves some attention and thoughtful, careful attention, because we don't want to just post it somewhere where just anyone can sign up onto the sheet, because that then puts a burden on the lead volunteer. If you have people showing up, if you have three people showing up or two people showing up that have never even been volunteering there, then suddenly the lead volunteer, it has pressure to get them up to speed. And that's not, so I think that we need to carefully think this through. It is really important. It is more important than understanding our financial situation, in my opinion. So we just really need to spend some energy on that. So I'm not sure how to make that happen, but we need to make it happen.
Yeah, I mean, the good news in terms of training new people is that usually the first couple of hours at the recenter are very slow. So it's an ideal time to take people around, to show them how it works, answer any questions they have. So I think that idea of on-the-job training is good. I mean, I think primarily when I'm looking at potential volunteers out there, I'm looking for people who have some people skills, you know.
Yeah. But I'm talking about people signing up.
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't want just anybody to sign up, because then if you have a new person or two new people sign up for the 10 to whatever shift or
right.
one, you know, the important shift, you've suddenly got people who don't know what they're doing and at the busiest time of day.
Right.
So I just want to think this through and try to have a process that.
Well, I think it's always good to have three experienced people there, a supervisor intake and at least one more person who's experienced. And then other people, sometimes we've had, you know, six people out there, and you can have a few people who are new who are just like seeing how it works.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And part of that is, you know, I tell people, like, listen to the conversations at the intake table, you know,
mm-hmm.
so you can hear how we accept or reject
mm-hmm.
stuff or negotiate with people or whatever.
Yeah.
And look at the kind of stuff that's on the shelves, you know, and there's a lot that people can pick up just by that.
Sure.
But
and
I
the
think,
weighing
yeah,
out position is also one that you can sort of not know that much and
yeah,
stay in one place. And
right, that's a really good entry level.
Well, it might be good to get a volunteer subcommittee, see who would volunteer for that.
Mm.
But, you know, we could have a little training. Show up training thing.
Yeah,
for all the different events too.
It used to be that anyone knew, and this is what I'd like to talk about is figure out what we can support and what should happen, or rather, what should happen and what we can support. I will be working with John later this summer to migrate the Gmail accounts over to another platform.
John.
And then John Celentano. And at that point we can start recruiting more heavily from our email base. It just needs some work before we do that.
Yeah.
So I could even send out a message to those people now. The groups that we have are larger than people interested in volunteering, which is not necessarily a bad thing. But anyway, so I would just like to talk about this and make a plan, because this is probably priority number one.
I would also just say that we have a terrific crew of several people on Wednesdays who are coming consistently. Elaine and Andrea Wolf. Who is a relatively new volunteer. They're both really creative, hard workers that go in there and make order and, you know, really restore it to, you know, looking orderly and clean and attractive and so forth. So they're doing a great job. Wednesdays is really
I want to note that Andrea is not from Northampton. She's from East Hampton.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure how relevant that is, but just in terms of the ReUse and being a Northampton resource. I mean, here's someone that's totally committed to zero waste. She is one of the most active. I've only worked with her once. That was last Saturday. But she was looking for things to do and
excellent.
Finding them and getting them done.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
Cleaning, painting, sanding.
That's great.
Really good.
Yeah,
that's great.
One of the things that I've been trying to really encourage is when people are out there, if it's slow, there's a lot of things, like Andrea has repainted some old furniture that has then become much more attractive and it's gone. Just rinsing or washing off some stuff really makes a difference. Sweeping the floor, you know, minor repairs. There's just a lot of things that people can do when they're out there if it's quiet that improve the.
And do we keep a little list of that if people are, or tell them, if people, if someone's out there and they're at loose ends, then?
I just usually tell them.
Tell them. Yeah, no, no, no.
It's hurt to have.
There is a whiteboard that we started that kind of a list.
Some things to do. Great.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Yeah.
But also some, you know, steps to do it for people who aren't still self-starters.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
How do you paint a chair? Where's the paint? Where are the brushes? Where do I do it?
That can be something they can speak before.
Can we, anything else for adult operations?
I,
David, did you?
Where is your role? Who do you report to?
I report to Donna
now. And that's, is that subject to change or?
Yes.
I mean, I think it's a logical connection.
David Valletta was recently, Donna announced just the other day that David Valletta has been promoted to city engineer. And
good.
Donna is looking at the department structure and it is subject to change. So I'm not certain my position is at this point an intermittent temporary employee. So where I'm placed is also, you know, in question, but I know that Donna is very supportive of what this committee and what I have done in relationship with this committee and elsewhere. So I'm not worried about whether my position is, you know, at risk. It's just
I'm thinking of the connection with the city, which is present through the DPW.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's logical and should be continued. And I think we should, if we need a home or an identity, we should be identified with the DPW.
I think we would go to sustainability or anything.
Well, that would be my notion, to work with Chris Mason under sustainability, because
mm-hmm.
that's really what our mission is. It's about sustainability. But
we can talk about that later.
So the roof update.
I did want to give you some statistics here. I'll just pass these around. There's not enough for everybody, so you'll have to share. But I have been entering the outtakes that we have been happening at the recenter. And for the months of April, May, and June, we have adopted out 4.2 tons of material. And this is made possible by our new scale and the system that was developed over the winter. So you can see here, it's an average of about 16 pounds per person. And you can see the number of visitors. We are getting about 170, 180 adopters per month. Now, that is a repeat number. If somebody comes every week, they're gonna be counted every week.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not completely accurate, but it gives us a nice kind of flavor.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to let you know about that. It's kind of interesting and exciting. So then the roof, we had Diana and I met with Ed Bosell from South Hadley, and he took a look at the roof and is going to be giving us an estimate. He just called me yesterday, Diana, and would like to go out there again. There's something else that he would like to see. He did notice the header beam that is not supported and called Dave Pomerantz and told him about it as we were there, and nothing has been done at this point. David Valletta, it feels that it's important, but it's not critical because it's been like that for a very long time. So we're looking at it. I believe Central Services is going to send Jonesy out there to take a look at it and shore it up. And so that's all in the works. It has not happened yet.
Have you heard from David Pomerantz?
I haven't heard from David Pomerantz,
but that's who
Jonesy
called.
Right.
Okay.
I meant to call him yesterday and it didn't happen because there was a mini crisis that happened. So I will call him.
Okay.
Follow up. So that's the roof update.
All right. 2015 report.
2015 report.
Oh.
Alan, do you
want to? Well, I most of you, if you've seen the email sent out at the draft, and have had lots of comments from lots of people. Susan made a lot of additions, and then had three other comments from different people about additional additions in reviews of that. I'm a little overwhelmed with all the suggestions and how to assemble it all at this point.
All the suggestions? So there were three people that responded. I didn't see them.
They didn't all go out to everybody.
Okay.
And so I guess I need to sort through all those and.
Well, I wanted to say you offered to get the ball rolling.
Yeah.
It does not mean that the monkey's on your back permanently.
Good.
So you've done a Herculean job, and you jump started. It's great. If you would like me to take it over from here, I can do that. Or you can continue. It's your choice.
Let me make some additions, and if you or anybody else wants to finish it up, that's fine.
Okay.
It's a work in progress.
Great.
I'm sorry, I've been a bit under the weather this week, so I haven't. That's just asthma, but I haven't been able to do too much. So.
Okay.
But I will get back to it.
You've done great. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Thanks for your work.
You can disregard all of that.
No.
I can make my suggestions much clearer. I mean, I can print the letter and then put it in.
It was a little hard to follow some of the suggestions.
Yes, right. No,
good
no,
ideas,
no. I can do that.
Went back and tried to figure it out.
No. I can make it easier to understand.
Okay. Anything else on that? Visioning report?
Is that the
retreat? Yeah, so the retreat, yeah.
Okay.
So the can you explain what happened for those who might not even be aware?
Right. The ReUse Center working group has been feeling like there isn't enough time in our regular meetings to look forward and sort of get an overview of what the ReUse Center is and it could be. And so we met over breakfast to have a longer, informal way to talk to each other. We talked about the history of the project and sort of the visions that we each had individually, and that we were recognizing that we were in a transition because of the administrative shifts that are happening with the new charter in the city and the mayor changing some stuff and the new staffing in the DPW. So we were recognizing our financial uncertainty as that we don't know how much money we have or how much we can spend or what we can spend it on. And the process of decision making and stuff is still uncertain, so we talked about that a little bit. And our relationship to this committee, the ReUse committee, and to the city, how the ReUse Center operates and who is the decision making body and how do we make that all work. And how do we set up a sustainable future and how do we grow from where we are. Peter had an idea about a more comprehensive resource recovery park that he wanted to call the Recreative Park. It was a longer title than that, I'm missing right now. So we talked about that. He presented that because it's something that we haven't had time to really look at a big vision. We talked about the physical changes that we've made to the building and the ones that we still need. Talked about staffing and support a little bit, and volunteering, and about building the movement of ReUse and repair, and what the ReUse Center could be, the building the community and the sort of the movement building around that. So that's a very brief overview of a four-hour meeting over coffee.
I was disappointed we didn't get to this whole issue about whether or not we should be auctioning things off and.
Right. That, I think, tied into our financial uncertainty of where we are and whether or not we're allowed to do that kind of fundraising.
Well, it also ties into what we need money for, which is a whole other bigger issue. We could probably have a. And this is what has stymied us in the past. We can have an auction, but what are we raising the money for?
Sure.
And until we know that, why go to the effort and work and agita of doing it?
So
the whole city structure thing you know, impacts the business about having a budget. And, you know, are we responsible for publicity costs, for example? Are we responsible for some of, whether you or your positions cost? Are we responsible
no,
for?
No, you're not responsible for money.
Right? Well, it's not, you know, none of it's clear. Mm-hmm. It's just kind of a muddled sort
right.
of thing, and it would be helpful, I think, for everybody to know what parts and pieces that, if we throw stuff into the landfill, are we responsible
right.
for paying
Keeping
for that?
Price.
You know,
yeah.
our,
right.
you know, all kinds of little pieces.
Utilities.
Don't,
right. And there's some clarity of that that you guys don't know that I'm going to get
okay.
next conversation.
Anybody else freezing in here?
No.
It is freezing.
It is cold.
Yeah.
My nose.
Soak it in.
So, yeah, that was, we had that very sort of broad, no decision making kind of a meeting, and the decision that came out of it was we should meet again in November. So you all are welcome to, if you want to do it again. And
when did you do it?
Sorry.
Oh, when did you do it?
When did we do it? June?
It was June 14th, I think.
Something like that.
Something like that.
Oh,
yeah.
What day of the week was that?
Tuesday, I think, was
mm-hmm.
it? Yeah.
It was a morning, yeah.
One of the challenges of the money conversations, we're now accumulating some things in the office.
Uh-huh.
The office is getting kind of full
uh-huh.
of stuff that we have question marks over whether we should try to sell or auction it or whatever.
We well, we always need a number there. There's
holes on my back.
It's also, it could be possible that we could do something online. I mean, there's lots of different possibilities.
Well, but for me, the first question that needs to be answered is,
sure.
is it something that morally or ethically we feel we can or want to do? Right? That's the
and
first question
that
needs to be asked.
Why do we want to do it? Why are we raising money? Because we're getting good stuff? That's not a good enough reason.
Well, no, that's not the reason. It seems it's what Alan just mentioned,
yeah.
and that is we don't have clarity about the amount of funding that we have. We do have expenses. There are things that we want to do. And frankly, we don't want to be told by the city, oh, you can't do that because there's not enough money for it.
Mm-hmm.
If we raised money, then we would be able to say, okay,
we
have money to do this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We have money to fix the roof. We have
or
money. The city will pay for that perhaps,
yeah.
but there will be other
yeah.
things.
Mm-hmm. Right. Hiring volunteer coordinators is one of the things
yeah.
that we'd love to do, but not sure if we can.
Put out those great postcards again about the pop-up events
right.
that everybody
right.
loved.
Right.
right.
Exactly. Okay.
Yeah. So are we finished with the
funding overview?
No, the vision report?
Yes.
Okay. So I just wanted to give you guys an explanation of what funding sources have been present in the past and what we have on the table right now. And the first one is one that was created in June of 2014, and that's a special revolving account that was created by the City Council for the ReUse Committee. And there is a limit of, I believe, $15,000 that we can accrue or accumulate.
It was 10 originally, right?
And yes, but it was approved in 2016 and it's 15. Okay? So this is for revenue generated from donations, fundraising, grants, and business, educational, and other institutional sponsorships. Allowable expenditures include advertising expenses, tipping fees, swap shop operating expenses, office supplies, expenses related to conducting workshops, fundraisers, and public events.
Impossible to record that list.
I'm sorry?
It was impossible to record that list, but we helped with that.
I have
point.
It written down.
Great.
So, yeah, sure. But there's something else here
right.
that I wanted to.
So you said include, that doesn't mean exclusive.
I'm sorry?
You said includes that list, but
it,
does that mean there's more?
I'm looking at the original piece that was put to City Council, and it said revenues will be generated from voluntary contributions, fundraising efforts, grants and business, educational and institutional sponsorships. Allowable expenses will include advertising expenses, tipping fees, swap shop operating expenses, office supplies, expenses related to conducting workshops, fundraisers, public events. So that's, so we have, typically we can't, a city, a municipality can't accept donations from people because it would, for a whole bunch of reasons. But this has been created as a place that we can do that. So that is, so that's number one, and that's something that I and the DPW and you guys have influence over, okay? Number two is this, this is a past funding source, the approximately $10,000 that was set aside or that was earmarked for our renovation expenses when we were first getting off the ground. And that's, that was a Board of Public Works thing. I was talking to Roe, I don't know the status of this, but it is the I'm gonna say Board of Public Works 10K earmark.
Is there any reason the two could not be combined, or?
Yes. There's, yes, the revolving fund is, it's just a different, it's for things that we raise from institutions. You know, Big Y wanted to give us a $600 donation towards our work. That's where it would go. So
it's not
so
city money.
It's not city money.
So is there any money at the moment?
So we used about $3,000 during our renovations. Whether or not we have access, whether or not that the remainder even exists anymore, or whether we have access to it is not clear. And because of the leadership changeover and the changes with the Public Works Commission and stuff, it's really not clear yet. I'm going to investigate that. That's part of why it's not easy to pull all this together.
Excuse me, to go back to the revolving account, is there any money in that account now?
Yes, there is about, I believe, $600 in there. And I will confirm that again. This, you know, this is part of another report, but this, I just wanted you guys to understand the different sources. The third is, and this is not our money, but it's money that we can ask for and have access to potentially, is the Department of Environmental Protection's Sustainable Materials Recovery Program grant. And that grant is an annual grant. This is the grant that I've told you about in the past that that the swap shop influences. Because of the existence of the swap shop, we get an extra couple of points, which allows us extra money from that grant. So this is, there are rules about what can and can't be spent out of this grant. So for instance, we can't spend it on food. I asked if we could spend it on techno trash and getting techno trash containers for the recenter so we could accept CD cases and stuff like that for recycling, and they said no. The signs that we have, so those exit signs, the signs we use for our pop-up events, the flagging, all those types of things can come out of this. Anything related to container and paper recycling and composting pretty much can come out of this. So there's a lot of, and because they are promoting the concept of the swap shop, and it's relatively new to the grant as a item of how you accrue points, they're interested in what we're doing and they are supportive of what we're doing. So there is money there. We get about, I don't know, maybe $4,000-ish a year from that. And if we have a compelling, if this group has a compelling reason to use some of that money and it fits into the criteria of the grant, we can put it out there. So that's another funding source. And then
I have a question. When we get the grant, it's we the DPW, we the solid waste, like you? Who?
I apply for the grant. It goes to the DPW.
Okay.
So yes. The DPW owns this.
Okay.
And we have, you know, we can ask,
right.
Hey, can we, you know, this is what paid for the scale.
Okay.
So we have it now. I mean, that is, this grant has been applied, and we applied for, and we've got it.
We have some money. The DPW has money, yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Do we need to know what stuff falls under that grant?
That's part two. This is part one, and part two is coming. Yeah. But I told you, essentially, it has to have to do with waste reduction.
Yes.
And composting, recycling. They're more open to swap shop, although that's kind of we're trailblazing here with mm-hmm. swap shop expenses. So the fourth is, and this again is this historical funding sources. The fourth has been DPW expense accounts, essentially. And so it's not clear to me. Ned is the one with institutional knowledge of what was charged to DPW as opposed to being paid out of, I mean, I know things that were paid out of the grant, but as far as the difference between this and this, I don't have the details yet. And again, that's one of the reasons why this isn't as simple as one would like it to be, as everyone wants it to be. So, for instance, advertising costs for our pop-up events. The pop-up events typically have been paid for out of the DPW expense account. It's my understanding that that's the case. So if we advertise the recenter, that would make sense for it to come out of this. But if we are advertising the toy exchange, I will argue that is something that should come out of this. So this all has to be clarified, and there's just a lot of stuff going on here in the department that has a higher priority. So it's not that it's not important, but you got to focus on critical things first. So I just wanted you guys to understand it's not, you know, so this is strict guidelines as to what you can spend it on. This is fairly strict guidelines what you can spend it on. This was created and was never promised. It was never said to us that you have $10,000, you can do whatever you want with. It was a $10,000 earmark for the construct. This is my understanding, and again, Ned's not here, and we'd have to go into the Board of Public Works Commission minutes to get the exact wording when this happened. But it was my understanding, I was told by Ned that this was for renovations and kickoff of the recenter. So Ro seems to think, and I don't want to put words in her mouth, but in past conversations, she seems to think that we might have access to some of that, but I don't know. So this is a big question mark, and then this needs to be clarified as far as what expenses come out of this versus our revolving account.
So number one and number two are unrelated.
Yes.
Because I thought that they were...
No, they are unrelated.
Except that they're both more related to the recenter than to the reuse committee.
Yes. Yes.
And then we have a number five, which is the donations.
No, the donations go into the revolving account.
Hmm. So, are they, like, you know, the $20 you get one weekend, and
mm-hmm.
do we have access to that?
Yeah, I have access to,
have
that,
access to that,
and
is that
something
listed separately in the revolving account as donations?
Part of the problem is that it was, when we get various donations, I don't get to see them and say this needs to go here or this needs to go there. So there was money put into that maybe shouldn't have been put into that. So for instance, the donations that we get from the toy exchange.
Yeah.
Technically, that's not a recenter thing. So, but those were put in, and so I need to look at all the things that have happened and understand them, and that just takes time.
Yeah, no, I understand all that, but I would think that people who are donating to the recenter would like to know that money is being used.
Sure.
For the recenter.
Sure. Okay. Sure. And yeah, absolutely. So that's just it's a project that I have not had time to take on. So Deb has begun being more specific when she enters the figures into the account. She's now delineating whether it's a recenter weekly contribution or something else. But that was not collected in the past.
Okay.
So we're just essentially looking at quantities and dates and figuring out what it could have been. So
mm-hmm.
clearly the one in December was from the toy exchange.
Yeah.
So that's a project, another project.
And with the change of administration, like our status change, what, I guess all of it's sort of up in the air?
No, the revolving account would stay.
Okay.
The revolving account, as an example, this is something, I don't know, is that pertinent?
Yeah, I don't need more clarification
on
that.
I
just had
I would I would think, I mean, number two, we need to find out more.
It's already fuzzy, yeah.
Number one is ours regardless.
Okay.
And it gets renewed every year by the city council. It was renewed recently for the amount of $15,000.
If we were restructured and put under sustainability, for example, we wouldn't be under the DPW or
Correct.
The DEP grants anymore?
Correct. The Sustainable Materials Recovery Program grant would likely not apply. We wouldn't have access to that money, but it's
strange,
possible
though.
That they have other money
available. Sustainability's, yeah, okay.
Yeah. So I just wanted you guys to understand. I realize you want it all at once. It's not going to happen all at once. So I'm going to feed you information, and this
Something's
was an easy
better.
Easy way to an easy feeding.
Susan, did I understand you correctly that the city is funding the revolving account $15,000 a year?
No, it's not funding it. We are allowed to collect or accrue up to $15,000 a year.
I see, okay.
Right now we have
$600.
Yes,
$600 right
maybe.
Now, okay.
Right, right.
There's a cap to the amount.
Right, so,
yeah.
So, we can accrue money and then use it for certain things.
I guess part of the discussion for how we want ourselves to be organized in the city
mm-hmm.
could have a lot to do with this. If we're going to lose access to the SMRP grants, then
mm-hmm.
is that how you say it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Papa SMRP and all the rest. Then we're going to have to pay attention to all that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I assume that the sustainability group has access to grants too. What grants they've access? It makes sense for us to have access to this because we're related to this reduction. And that's what it's all about. Now, that grant also has portions, there are pieces of that grant where you can request certain things. You could, there's not a whole lot of leeway. It's usually requesting things like a dumpster to collect mattresses for recycling or something like that. But there are often little opportunities that one can take to get a special program funded. And that's what Karen had done when she kicked off the pop-up event things. And that's where she had money to buy, vests and all this stuff to get the pop-up thing going. So there are opportunities like that. the grant application is due in June, but fairly easily we can get from the grant at this time, the DPW can get about $5,000 a year.
Okay. Are we done talking about funding? Is there a new business?
I had something, but if somebody else has something first.
Well, the next meeting is already scheduled, right? That's, I think
well,
that was
the next
in the
meeting, I would like to look at that.
August
it is
11th.
The minutes. It's August 11th?
Yes.
I need to look at that because I might not be able to make August 11th. But before we go there, I spoke with a man, the folks at the MRF, because we had questions about bulky rigid plastic. And she said that black plastic we had a couple specific questions. And one, there was a woman who'd been collecting those to-go containers, and she had a big stack of them, and she said Karen always took them. These trays are a no, and it is because based on their composition, the materials don't break down the way they need and can spoil an entire batch of new product during the cleaning and processing stages that come long after they leave the mark. Also, because there are so many different kinds, there's no way for the factories to sort out which are good and which are bad. An example are the freezer to microwave TV dinner containers, bad for trying to recycle, similar to why ice cream containers are not recyclable either.
Ice cream containers?
Paper ones?
What kind of ice cream containers?
Mm-hmm. I don't know what she's talking about.
Well, maybe the hard plastic ones and not the paper ones.
Because the paper ones are like milk cartons, right?
They're
recyclable.
Right. Then I asked about clarification about what is small and what is bulky. And that is, she says it's a vague term.
That's why we're asking.
And I didn't get an answer on that, even though I asked a couple of times. She said, we accept things as small as children's plastic toys and certain clothing hangers. But not the clothing hangers. I had a call from the gazebo, woman at the gazebo, who has, you know, all of the material that she gets from China, et cetera, all the bras are on these cheesy plastic hangers, which she takes off. She takes the bras off and throws them away. And she called to see if there was a way to get them recycled. So I sent pictures, et cetera, to the MRF. And she said, unfortunately, we can't accept them, not only because they aren't bulky, rigid plastic, but because the revenue shares contracts, which we bring material to the MRF through, is for residential recycling, not commercial recycling. So this person would have to, even if, but they don't even qualify for bulky rigid plastic anyway, but if they did, it would be problematic.
That would be petty.
Yeah.
To reject it because it didn't come from residents.
But it doesn't apply anyway. So I did want to let you know that through a MRF grant, the MRF essentially holds back a certain amount of money from the revenues due to the municipalities that sign the contracts for an education fund. And this education fund accrues over time. And the MRF advisory board has had various grant programs that help educate the public by giving the municipalities supplies or whatever that they can distribute to their people. So they have had educational grants lately, which are things like big posters, the magnets. I don't know if you've seen the magnets that Deb had available with pictures of what types of things can get recycled in your container recycling, paper recycling, which things can't. So we've had magnets, we have flyers, we have things like that. Those are all made available to us through the MRF grant, which is an annual grant. I have, you know, the posters that various kindergarten teachers and others borrow. Those are for the grant. So we have, this is the second year that they've had this educational grant. So I wanted to let you know that the MRF Advisory Board people developed a new poster for bulky rigid plastic. There are two new posters this year. One is bulky rigid plastic,
right,
and it has pictures of the types of things that are good, and I have ordered several of them for use at our events and at the Lendale Road station. The second poster that's newly available is one that says recycling's most unwanted. And it's a pictorial thing with a, you know, no kind of symbol in it of the 10 most unwanted items
What's number one?
I don't remember what number one is, but rubber hoses, plastic bags, those are two big ones. Rubber hoses and plastic bags might be number one.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I wasn't listening carefully about the black plastic. Is it all black plastic, or is it just those?
I asked specifically about the trays. In general, black plastic for bulky?
Yeah.
Oh, for bulky, it's not a problem because we do flower pots and stuff like that.
So, so that plastic flower pots are okay.
For bulky, rigid plastic collection, right. In general, it is not a problem.
Oh, okay.
It is a problem, it tends to be a problem with your container recycling, your household container recycling.
Oh, but that was the question. The woman came to bulky, rigid plastic because she knew she couldn't put it into her household recycling.
Yeah, but they weren't plastic trays. These were these reheatable black trays.
Well, they were plastic trays. They were like takeout container trays. Right. So she can't put them in her container recycling because black plastic is not, there isn't a market for black plastic.
Right, but she brought them to bulky rigid.
But they aren't bulky rigid. She's saying she doesn't want them in bulky rigid.
Okay.
So, as an aside, mm-hmm. I don't know how this information gets to gatekeepers mm-hmm. and transfer station, but I've gotten mixed messages about black plastic.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And I see it in the containers all the time. So mm-hmm. if it's not the top one, it's certainly up mm-hmm. there.
Sure.
So there needs to be some more education.
Yeah,
people are bringing black plastic trays to the recenter in front of us. Can we tell them to put them in the bulky rigid plastic containers up? At the transfer station.
Uh-huh.
Are we allowed to tell people to put those?
No, they can't go into bulky rigid. She's saying that she doesn't want them in bulky rigid.
But other black plastic can.
Other black plastic can because of black plastic.
Black plastic
little
flower
tight
pots.
Things, flower pots. Yeah.
They can go in.
They can go in.
The trick.
Yeah, I mean you have to. So here's the thing, you guys.
Yeah.
Sort of.
When you are doing recycling education in the public. You have to keep the message simple.
Yeah.
So there's this warring kind of, there's two forces out there. One is people are smart, people are happy to do the sorting, people are enthusiastic, and we're gonna tell them what can be recycled and what can't. But it's very, very complicated. Mm-hmm. And some people get overwhelmed and they think it's too complicated, I don't want them to screw around with that, forget it, and they throw it in the trash.
Right.
So then the other camp says, we want people to recycle as much as they can. If they throw the wrong stuff in, we're not gonna yell at them because we want them to recycle. We don't want them to get turned off. Mm-hmm. So we're just gonna say, bottles and cans and tubs and jars, put it in. And so it's a tightrope
right.
You're between the two things because we are all enthusiastic, but the majority of the public is not, and they want it to be simple.
Right.
So the MRF's message is bottles, cans, tubs, jars, you know, they don't say trays, they don't say, you know, so.
They don't
say
flower pots.
If you go, they don't say flower pots because that's bulky rigid plastic,
right.
Which is a different stream. So when you go to the MRF, it's springfieldmrf.org, I think, or springfieldmrf.gov, maybe. I think it's .org. They have pictures and they have explanations. You can drill down in the detail if you want to,
mm-hmm.
but it's not something that they push
yeah.
because they don't want people to get put off.
Yeah.
Well, it's certainly confusing for us as we're
yeah.
advising people.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
and
we have to mix up
the bulky rigid.
Right. Alan, you have to understand, it's not just confusing for us, it's confusing for the experts because
yeah. right.
we only have a 1 through 7 resin categorized, and there are thousands of kinds of plastics.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really a judgment call for many of these plastics about
absolutely.
Whether or not they
right.
belong in
and
bulky
even,
rigid plastic.
And even, you know, in that resin identification system, just so you know, and I've said this before, so forgive me if you're already aware of that. That was created by the plastics industry, and at the time in the 1970s, they chose to use the chasing arrows as part of their resin identification system. So those chasing arrows for 40 years have confused people because they think that means that
recyclable.
It's recyclable.
Mm-hmm.
It's not necessarily recyclable, it's just a resin identification. So that's number one. Number two, because it's resin and it's got a 2 on it, does not mean that there's a market for it, because sometimes manufacturers using that resin add chemicals to it so that they can use it in an extraction molding process or something like that. So if bottles that are blow molded or blown into the mold typically don't need extra chemicals. Bottles or other objects that are injection molded, you have to add special chemicals to the resin, inject them into the mold, and then what happens is the manufacturers, they don't want the chemicals in their PET. They want the kind, they want the bottles, because the bottles are blow molded. So it's a very, very complicated thing out there. And so for a long time, those clear clamshells that you get so much at the delis were not wanted by the MRF, because they are injection molded and their primary manufacturing or sector that purchased PET with carpeting industry, and the carpeting industry doesn't want the chemical stuff, because when they try to make carpet out of it, it turns into a big gooey mess. So it's a very complicated thing. It's always changing. So they found a market for the gooey PET plastic, and now that they can accept clamshells at the MRF. And what makes it even more complicated is that we have a really excellent MRF that works hard to find regional manufacturing organizations that buy its material, and they have long-term contracts with these organizations. But if you go into New York State or into New Jersey, their MRF might not work as hard at it, or they might not have access to the markets that we do. So you could recycle something here and know with pretty some certainty that it's going to actually wind up as another product, whereas you go to New Jersey and they're going to tell you to put it in the trash. Mm-hmm. It's a very complicated, confusing world. So,
okay. That's more new business?
It's SpringfieldMRF.org.
I don't think,
easy to find.
Yeah, I don't think I do.
Okay.
I don't think I do. However, we need to look at the dates.
Next meeting, right.
They have a lot of posters. Yes and no.
Oh, do they?
Yeah.
Well, that's good.
Yes, the 11th. The 10th, the 11th of August, I believe, is going to be difficult for me. Yes, it will be. I have something in that I need to do. I'm not going to be in town.
That would be difficult then.
That would be difficult. So we can
the
change
it. The 18th?
We could change it to the 9th if you want to try for a Tuesday. The 18th is also going to be difficult. It's going to be impossible for me.
If we do it on the 9th, we could make the focus of that meeting the administrative change, you know, what we're going to be. I mean, because it's pretty soon, right? The night
right,
is
right.
Just a couple weeks away. So, but certainly there are things to go over, including funding overview. So, how about
anybody that won't be around the
it's
night?
Possible.
I won't be here tonight.
It's possible that we could make it. We could make the 10th as well. The 9th or the 10th.
Oh, you don't mean the. Oh, you mean the 9th, the Tuesday, the 9th?
Mm-hmm. Tuesday the 9th or Wednesday the 10th.
Oh, that would be. Changing things,
mm-hmm.
right?
Changing the whole
yes.
day.
Yeah, that would be changing the whole,
yeah.
yeah.
So the 4th is the
I could
Thursday.
Also do a doodle to find out what day works best mm-hmm. for most people.
That's probably.
How about the 4th of August?
The 4th of August is possible.
Particularly if we're going to be talking about.
Yeah, that's true.
And we probably start talking about the fall pop-up events, so maybe earlier mm-hmm. in August is better.
Mm-hmm.
September,
4th of August, Mac, are you around?
No.
Kayaking?
Sounds like doodle is the way to go, Susan.
Okay, I'll do a doodle.
Sierras?
I'll do a doodle. All
right, is there a motion to adjourn?
No move.
Okay.
Oh, before we
yeah.
vote on that.
Well, we're adjourned, but we can still talk.
Before we adjourn, the 2015 recenter report, do we need to have a vote to accept that? Or do we need to have a vote to accept it in its...
Well, it's not done.
It's not done, but there are not going to be major changes done.
Why not? But why don't we wait till it's done and then we can...
Okay.
Is there a need to have it done that?
Well, it's July. And it's nice that it's done. We, you know, I mean, yes, we've waited this long. Why not a couple more weeks? You could argue, but if it's something that could be done,
I think there are a number of comments suggesting that we might want to wait till it's done.
Okay. Okay.
Prove it.
All right.
Good.
Adjourn.
Adjourn.